Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Angels Are For Real, Inspiring True Stories and Biblical Answers by Judith MacNutt. Narrated by Nan McNamara. Foreword. I count it a high privilege to be married to Judith. And we have often talked about encounters with angels. The topic is so interesting that I encouraged Judith to write this book. There are already some excellent books on the subject, and many people think back to Billy Graham's outstanding book, Angels, God's Secret Agents. Judith's book combines a scriptural study of angels together with experiences that show why angels are important in our journey of salvation. They are not just symbolic. They are real and touch our lives. Teaching on angels goes back as far as Genesis and comes forward as far as this week's television programs. Furthermore, Judith and I are blessed to be surrounded by Christians who have their own extraordinary stories of encounters with the angelic host. Just yesterday, a member of our Christian Healing Ministry staff told us about an angelic encounter. Over the years, I have often asked groups of people, "How many of you believe that you have personally encountered an angel?" It has impressed me that usually about half of the group will raise their hands. I think that is a remarkable statistic, not to mention a remarkable reality. You might just ask the same question of your own prayer group or of your friends. Just think, in a typical group of people sitting quietly in church, you will probably find, if you draw them out, that about half can tell you about a very personal encounter that they themselves have had with angels. The stories we hear are fascinating, and you will hear some of them in this book. I hope you can learn something in this book about why the ministry of angels is such an incredible gift to us. Among other blessings, they protect us, warn us, and guide us. I am deeply inspired by how God has helped us over the years by sending us His angels. In reading the stories from Judith's early life and those stories submitted by friends, I was happily surprised. I am not one to cry easily, but as I read Judith's story about finding her father's ring, I was deeply moved. It is so encouraging to believe that God has appointed an angel to guard us, a guardian angel to protect us from danger and evil of every kind. Generations of Christians have believed this, but most of us hold this belief on faith because angels are usually unseen. Unseen or not, they actively influence our lives in very real ways. Surveys indicate that about half of theologians believe they are real, while the other half believe that they are merely a symbolic way of talking about God's activities. Judith has written this book because in addition to believing in angels, you can also experience their actions as they impact your life. I also encourage you to pray in such a way that you may come to recognize their presence in your life as they lovingly act to protect you, guardian angels, or guide you, messenger angels. Even if you do not see angels blessing and helping you, they actually do assist you in extraordinary ways. If you truly believe that God has assigned angels to teach, to protect, and to guide you, it can encourage you tremendously in your prayer life when you pray asking for their protection and guidance. The many testimonies included in this book show how much God loves us and how, at times, He may even save our lives through the powerful intervention of angels. Learning more about angels will naturally lead you to lift prayers of praise and gratitude to God. Angels are real. Francis McNutt. 1. A Gift from My Father. Many years ago, before Francis and I married, I experienced an angelic encounter that radically altered my perception of the invisible spiritual realm. Allow me to share with you the mysterious story that opened me up to the world of angels and demons, and ultimately led me to understand more about God Himself. I had just returned home from a lovely evening with good friends, and I was preparing for bed. The hour was later than usual for me, and I had a full day's work ahead of me at my counseling practice in Clearwater, Florida. During that time, my work days began with early morning prayers at my church, followed by a quick breakfast, and then 8 to 10 hours of counseling with my clients. I loved the quiet times of inner healing ministry to the broken-hearted, depressed, and suffering ones who came to me. I delighted at being a small part of the transformation process of their lives. God's great love for each one of them became evident to me, and above all, to them in this process. Exhausted and in need of a good night's sleep, I began my bedtime ritual, changing into something cozy, brushing my teeth, locking the doors, removing a cross necklace, earrings, a watch, and my ring. I stared at my bare ring finger in shock. My beautiful diamond and sapphire ring was missing. My heart sank. It had simply disappeared. I had not felt it slip off my finger. How could I have lost it? Where could it be? Grabbing a flashlight, I began my frantic search, praying all the while, God, please help me find my ring. I searched my bedroom, every inch of my condo, the sidewalk, the garage, and my small sports car. After retracing my path from the car to the bedroom 3 times, I realized the ring had not fallen anywhere in or around my home or car. Frantically, I phoned the restaurant where I had eaten dinner, asking the staff to search around the table where I had been seated. I then phoned my friends at whose house I had enjoyed dessert after dinner, asking them to look for it. After what seemed like an eternity, the kind restaurant manager and my friends both phoned back to say that my ring had not been found. I was overwhelmed with sadness at the loss of this precious ring. Unwilling to accept my loss, I wandered around my home, hoping against all odds to find it. Around midnight, I gave up my search. Overcome with grief, I sank into the wicker rocking chair in my bedroom and began to cry. How could I have lost it? Blaming myself became easy. So many questions were tumbling through my mind. The sense of loss became too much. I had such a deep attachment to that ring. And for a very special reason. My mind returned to the warm, sunny afternoon in Nassau when my father had unexpectedly given me the ring. My dad and I had flown to the Bahamas to celebrate my 30th birthday. My older brother, J.C., who was sailing the islands for a year in his sailboat, came to Nassau too. My dad had not left his home in Kentucky since my mother's sudden death 7 years earlier, and I looked forward to this trip as a time of much-needed healing between us. My mom had been the glue that held our family together. Since her death, we had drifted far apart. We rarely saw each other, and when we had come together in the past for the holidays, we felt strained and uncomfortable. Now, we were planning to spend an entire week aboard a 55-foot sailboat. Anticipating the close quarters we would share over the next few days, physically and emotionally, the afternoon before we set sail, I grabbed my dad and pulled him toward the gangplank and said, "Let's go shopping. It's my 30th birthday and I've decided to buy a ring." Being the rugged mountain man that he was, setting his feet on dry, solid ground again was very appealing to Dad, even though he detested shopping. We wandered through several jewelry stores on the main street before venturing onto a side street and discovering a small and lovely shop owned by a local designer. The rings in the shop were beautifully displayed in a few well-lit cases and were sorted by price. As I had fun trying on the rings that suited my budget, I noticed my dad had walked over to look at the pricier rings. I selected a small gold ring with a simple floral design, nothing fancy, but unique and beautiful. I called my dad over to get his opinion. After glancing at it, he surprised me when he said, "I don't like it. There's one in this other case I want you to see." He took me by the arm and led me over to the most elegant ring section in the shop. I had glanced at the rings in that case, but had quickly realized they were too expensive. Pointing to a particular ring, Dad said, "I believe this ring was made just for you." As I began to protest, the clerk quickly removed the ring from the case and handed it to me. Dad encouraged me. Try it on. I slipped it on my finger. It was a perfect fit. Never before had I seen a ring that danced with such light and beauty. The ring was crafted with a wide striated gold band containing a small diamond, and brilliant blue sapphires nestled themselves around the centerpiece. Though I loved it immediately, I twisted it off my finger, mumbled concerns about the expense, and handed it over to the disappointed clerk. I then looked into my father's beautiful green eyes, saw them brimming with tears, and saw the pure love that was on his face. He smiled ever so tenderly, took my hand, and said, "This ring is my gift of love to you. Whenever you wear it, wherever you are in life, always remember that your father loves you." As I accepted his gift of love, my heart began to soften. At that moment, memories of my teen years full of stormy arguments with Dad and painful recollections were forgiven. The little girl inside of me, the one longing to be loved and accepted by her daddy, faced her father in that moment with an indescribable joy filling her heart. The ring became a symbol to me of Dad's love and of our family's healing. The assurance of his love, sealed forever in my heart, was covering the deep wounds I had carried since my teens. This was the threshold of a new beginning for us and for our family. As I remembered the story and was jolted back into reality, I realized that now that precious ring was gone. As the memories receded, my deep sense of loss returned. Sitting in the darkness, I realized I had to find the courage to surrender my painful loss to God and allow Him to enable me to move beyond my sadness. I vacillated between surrender and sorrow. Loss affects us in this way. My clinical training reminded me all too much of the process of grief in that moment. Sometimes we prefer to cling to our misery, thereby postponing acceptance, release, comfort, and healing. I was so afraid that if I surrendered the ring, I would be giving up my father's love. I realize now that those thoughts were not true or logical, but I was not thinking logically during this crisis. I was clinging desperately to what the ring symbolized, not just clinging to the ring. It had served as a constant reminder of a golden moment in time. At that point, I reached for my Bible. My mother had always said, "Whenever you feel discouraged, read your Bible." I found the passage with Jesus' story of the woman diligently searching for her lost coin. Next, I read about the loving father who waited, looking longingly for his lost prodigal son. Slowly, I realized that nothing that is real, such as love, is ever lost. The prodigal son lost all his possessions, but not the beautiful love between his father and himself. Was it possible to stop clinging to the symbol of my father's love, the ring, yet hold tightly to the forever love that was in my heart? As I prayerfully turned my dilemma over to God, I finally accepted the necessity of releasing the ring, not the love it symbolized. As I prayed, the ache in my heart slowly diminished, replaced by the comforting presence of God. I prayed, "Thank you, Father, for the loving relationship Dad and I have been blessed with, for all the healing you have brought about to restore us. Thank you, too, for the joy of wearing that beautiful ring that symbolized Daddy's love. I release to you my precious ring, and I pray that whoever finds it will also experience the great joy and love I knew." Leaving my Bible on my wicker rocker, where I had almost fallen asleep, I crawled into bed. I nestled under my mother's warm hand-pieced quilt. As I settled into the drowsy stillness that precedes sleep, I offered one more prayer. "Lord, you know I've released the ring. If it's not too much trouble, would you send an angel to return it to me? Never in my life had I prayed for God to send angels to do anything, much less to return a lost ring. Feeling slightly embarrassed by my frivolous request, I drifted off to sleep. The following morning, my alarm awakened me after only 3 precious hours of sleep. Feeling somewhat groggy, I rushed to dress so I would not be late for morning prayers at my church. I could still be on time if I moved quickly. As I backed my car out of the garage, I felt I heard a voice saying, "Go back inside. Your ring is there." I knew the ring was not there, however, so I continued on my way. About a mile from home, I heard the voice again. Only this time, the tone was louder and definitely more insistent. "Turn around and go home." Feeling somewhat confused, I found a place to turn around, and I headed home. The voice had disturbed me, especially the demanding tone. Why should I look at home for my ring? I thought. I searched every inch of the place last night, so I'm wasting time. This will make me late for church. Upon my arrival, I unlocked the door and entered my silent home, glancing around as I walked through the rooms. When I reached my bedroom, I felt a flash of sadness as I remembered my loss and the drama from the previous night. "Shake it off," I told myself, "and get on with your day. Coming home was a mistake. Go to church." Suddenly, I was immobilized by a strange sensation. Something had radically altered in the atmosphere around me. I had not switched on the light, and heavy shades still blocked the early morning sun. I had never been a morning person, so I took great care to maintain a dark sleeping space. Slowly, like the sun rising at dawn, a light crept across the bedroom floor, growing brighter by the moment. Someone unseen, who reflected the brilliance of God, was there. A holy presence whose brightness seeped into every corner of the room. I was reminded of the sun's light as it reflects off the morning dew, like thousands of tiny diamonds refracting the light and covering the dew-drenched earth. Feeling slightly uncomfortable with this presence, I started to inch my way out of the room. As I backed out to leave, a sparkle of dancing light caught my eye. Looking for the source of the sparkle, I walked over to the corner where I had sat in my rocker the night before. There, on the flowered seat cushion, my Bible lay right where I had left it. I leaned closer to get a better look. And there, on top of my Bible, placed by unseen hands, was my beloved ring. Stunned, I thought, "This is impossible." Suddenly, I felt weak. Tears filled my eyes, blurring my vision. As a psychotherapist, my next thought was, "I must be hallucinating, seeing things and hearing strange voices." I actually was afraid to reach for the ring. I felt as though I were in a dream. Instead of picking it up, I touched it, ever so gently. It was real. I was astonished. It was not a dream or a vision. Placing the ring on my finger, I laughed and cried at the same time. Indescribable feelings of wonder, awe, and joy flooded my entire being. Torrents of praise and thanksgiving to God rushed out of my grateful heart. Never before had I felt so completely alive or so confused. Then the flood of unanswered questions began. How did the ring get there? I had just been reading the Bible a few hours before. The ring could not have been there. Then I remembered my last request to God before falling asleep. "Please send an angel to return my ring." Was it possible that God had commanded a mighty angel to find it? Did the angel place it on top of my Bible so I would know that I could not have overlooked it in my search? Was the insistent voice I heard in the car the voice of an angel? All unanswered questions. Totally perplexed by these unusual occurrences, I rushed to my car and drove straight to church. The service was still underway, so I slipped into a pew at the back. Opting to skip breakfast and spend time in prayer, I remained on my knees, thanking God and also seeking answers. As I thanked God for all He had done to bring about this miracle, an overwhelming sense of His presence enveloped me. My questions fell silent as I waited for Him in that sacred space. And then He spoke. His voice, so deeply resonant within me, was full of tenderness and love. "You know your earthly father loves you. I have commanded my angel to bring you this ring because I long for you to know that your heavenly father loves you too. This ring is my gift of love to you too. It is now twice given, and you are doubly blessed." Out of that marvelous, life-altering experience, the greatest longing of my heart was fulfilled. To know and to be known intimately by my Abba, my Daddy. Abba is the Aramaic word that Jesus used when referring to God. It is the intimate, familiar term used to indicate the closeness of their relationship. This divine encounter increased and further shaped my understanding of the unseen spiritual realm in which angels dwell. When we embrace the ministry of the holy angels, we begin to comprehend the loving care of our Heavenly Father. He created these majestic, powerful beings to be our companions throughout our earthly journey. In the following chapter, we will discover together what an angel is by studying scriptural references. And I will share inspiring, true life stories of angelic encounters from people just like you. 2. What is an angel? Several years ago, while teaching at a conference on healing in Ogunquit, Maine, I felt the Holy Spirit was directing me to give a teaching on angels. At that time, I certainly believed in the existence of angels, but I had never considered teaching or writing about them. I did not consider myself an authority on the subject, and still do not, so I tried to change to another topic, one with which I felt more comfortable, more knowledgeable. The longer I prayed, however, the more blank my mind became. I finally realized that I had to return to the original topic of angels. After I spent several hours searching scripture, an outline began to take shape. I gave the lecture on angels, but because of my limited knowledge, I asked the sound technician not to record the teaching. I did not want it to be publicly available. I was too concerned about my own inadequacy. The attendees, however, were very receptive and seemed extremely disappointed that the lecture had not been recorded. A few years later, I discovered that the sound technician had, in fact, recorded it and had been distributing it at no cost. That teaching on angels became a source of comfort and encouragement to many people. Since that time, I have continued to study angels, and I now realize that their ministry is extremely vital to individuals, to the church, and to the advancement of the kingdom of God. Most of the observations I make throughout this book come from Scripture. A few others come from my own experiences with angels or from the experiences of others. Yet we all agree that angels are real and play an important role in furthering the kingdom of God. God created angelic beings before He formed the earth or created humans. Every major religion in the world accepts their existence. They are seen as agents of the divine, supernatural, powerful, loving, wise, and devoted to God's service. In his Institutes, John Calvin said, "Angels are the dispensers and administrators of the divine beneficence toward us. They regard our safety, undertake our defense, and direct our ways." The great church reformer Martin Luther stated that angels are spiritual creatures created by God without a body for the service of Christendom and the church. Classical writers such as Shakespeare, Dante, and Milton either mention angels or give us their deeper insights into the invisible realm. Angels have been celebrated in art for centuries. Well-known artists such as Fra Angelico, Leonardo da Vinci, El Greco, and Thomas Cole have portrayed various images of angels, ranging from pillars of light to brightly robed human-like figures with and without wings. Angels have been celebrated in poetry, music, and books. Artists have portrayed them as mighty warriors, defending and protecting, or as compassionate, tender beings, offering comfort and encouragement. During ministry trips to different parts of the world, I constantly meet ordinary people who have had extraordinary supernatural encounters with God's holy angels. These experiences are not rare, but for most people, they are unexpected. Are angels appearing more frequently? Or is our spiritual hunger for meaning opening our eyes to God's unseen servants? A 2007 Gallup poll found that 75% of Americans believe in angels, and 50% believe they have their own guardian angels. Today, however, many theologians de-emphasize the supernatural realm, which includes angels. On the other hand, people are seeking assurance that a loving God and His angelic hosts are actively involved in their day-to-day lives. They want to believe that angels are not only involved with us, but are capable of intervening to bring us assistance. With our current economic challenges, our fractured social network, and the breakdown of the traditional family with its 50% divorce rate, life poses many difficulties. Anxiety disorders, depression, and addictions are increasing at an alarming rate and often result in job loss, divorce, suicides, and frequent hospitalizations. At the root of many of these psychological disorders is a deep spiritual sickness, a basic loneliness created by a culture detached from a loving God. A comment I often hear in counseling is, "I feel so alone and powerless." Our deepest need is to love and be loved. This comes about through an intimate relationship with God, the source of all love. St. John of the Cross, a 16th century mystic and theologian, taught that the more misery people endured, the more God gave them mercy. As our miseries have increased, God in His mercy has provided these mighty angels to bring His unfailing love to us throughout our lives. Angels are not meant to replace an intimate relationship with God. They are messengers who convey God's love in real and tangible ways. Their presence brings comfort and strength. An angel is a stepping stone to the larger reality, God's kingdom, and ultimately points us to God Himself. Why learn about angels? One purpose is to teach our families, especially our children. Another is to encourage people who are struggling, to let them know that they have a spiritual companion with them on their earthly journey, that they are not alone, and that their angelic companion reflects God's great love for them. In his Christianity Today article, Rumors of Angels, Timothy Jones commented, "Even among intellectuals, the notion of heavenly visitors strikes a responsive chord." Mortimer Adler, philosopher and editor of the Great Books series, tells how he gave a lecture under the auspices of the Aspen Institute for Humanistic Studies. His topic? Angels and angelology. "The announcement," he wrote, "drew an audience larger than any I have ever enjoyed in the last 30 years. The experience so moved him that he wrote a book on the philosophical significance of angels." We long to know more, but we need to exercise caution when learning about angels. Much of the available information is not based on scripture or on church teachings. Many New Age books and courses encourage us to contact spirits from the unseen realm, which can ultimately lead to dangerous connections with evil fallen angels. Paul warns the church in Colossae, "Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you." Such a person goes into great detail about what he has seen. He has lost connection with the head. Colossians chapter 2, verses 18 through 19. The emphasis on the head, meaning God, challenges us to stay focused on God, not on angels who are His servants. Twice, on the island of Patmos, the Apostle John fell at the feet of an angel to worship him. Immediately the angel said, "Do not do it. I am a fellow servant with you and with your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God." Revelation chapter 19, verse 10. See also chapter 22, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 7 and 14 says, "In speaking of the angels, he, God, says, 'He makes his angels winds, his servants flames of fire.' Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation?" I believe angels on assignment choose to remain invisible if possible in order to avoid this very human response of adoration and worship. Their desire is to serve as messengers for the living God, not to be worshiped. I love to receive flowers, but when they are delivered, I know that the delivery person is only the messenger, the bearer of the gift. Someone who loves me sent the flowers, just as our Father sends us his holy angels, the messengers of his unfailing love. The creation of angels. In writing to the church at Colossae, Paul addresses the supremacy of Jesus Christ over all creation, both visible and invisible. Paul also confirms that the entire universe, including the angels, was created by God. Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 16 says, "He, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. All things were created by him and for him." The Psalms also speak about the creation of angels. "Praise him, all his angels praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created." Psalm 148, verses 2 and 5. God's spoken word in the creation account revealed that when he said, "Let there be light," and there was light. He spoke, and the entire creation came into being. Genesis chapter 1, verse 3. The exact time of the angels' creation is uncertain, but several scriptural references give us clues. The greatest one is in Job chapter 38, where the Lord answered Job by asking, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation, while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy?" Verses 4 and 7. This suggests that the angels were present when God created the world and that they shouted for joy. The other clue is in the account of Adam and Eve, who yielded to the serpent's temptation in the Garden of Eden. This timeline suggests that the fallen Lucifer, Satan, the adversary of Adam and Eve, was present before the creation of mankind. The creation of countless angels seems to coincide with the creation of heaven, before the physical earth was formed. The nature of angels. God created angels as a separate class from humans, and they possess higher levels of wisdom, authority, and holiness than humans. Their many superior qualities were inherent from the very beginning. Angels are rational, intelligent beings with unique personalities. They display a full range of emotions. Throughout Scripture, references are made to angels expressing joy, sorrow, anger, and compassionate love. Jesus said in Luke chapter 15, verse 10, "In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Angels are extremely joyful. We see this the night Jesus was born in Bethlehem. The shepherds heard countless numbers of angels joyfully singing as the heavens split open to reveal their presence. Angels also have the ability to communicate or impart to us what is in their nature, such as peace, joy, and patience. The angels' emotions are not impaired by sin. Our human emotions, as well as our bodies, carry the wounds of sin. This is one of the reasons we experience so much fear, anxiety, anger, and sorrow. Angels' emotions function perfectly, the way God intended. Angels are also humble, obedient, patient, and pure. They possess a fierce loyalty to God and long to serve Him by obediently ushering in His kingdom. Angels were given a free will by God, allowing them the freedom to choose and to determine their direction in life. The holy angels remain totally submitted to the will of God, unlike the unholy fallen angels.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.